Hello, this quick tutorial covers the PowerSum Crosstalk field testing parameters, two of several that must be verified to ensure standards compliance for the installed link or channel. Let's begin with a definition of PowerSum Crosstalk. Crosstalk measures the amount of signal sent over one pair in a cable that leaks or is detected on an adjacent pair. If there's too much leakage, it can affect signal integrity on the adjacent pair. In earlier days, network technologies such as 10 megabit Ethernet and 100 megabit Ethernet used only two pairs for signaling, one to transmit and one to receive. So crosstalk was measured on a pair-to-pair basis. At gigabit rates, however, all four pairs simultaneously transmit and receive. Therefore, the signal on any one pair can experience interference from the simultaneous or power sum leakage from the three other pairs. As shown here, when the crosstalk measurement is at the signaling source end, it's referred to as power sum near-end crosstalk or PS next testing. And since we're measuring the relative difference between the strength of three signals and the combined strength of their leakage, a higher decibel or dB value is better. It means there's more signal energy and less leaked energy. Let's now take a look at measuring PowerSum crosstalk at the destination end, or the far end, of the link or channel. PowerSum crosstalk at the far end will always be lower on longer links or channels than on shorter ones, because of attenuation or insertion loss, which reduces the strength of any signal over the length of a cabling run. So, in order to provide a test limit applicable to every possible link or channel length, the PowerSum crosstalk calculation at the far end is adjusted for the attenuation measured on the link or channel. The resulting value is called the PowerSum attenuation to crosstalk ratio far end, or PSACRF. We'll finish this module with a review of the published PS Next and PSACRF limits for categories 5E, 6, 6A, and 8. The applicable standard is the Telecommunications Industry Association, or TIA, 568.2-D, titled Balanced Twisted Pair Telecommunications Cabling and Component Standard. There are two sets of limits, one for maximum 100-meter end-to-end channels and the other for maximum 90-meter permanent links. The channel limits are lower because of the cords added at both ends. Note that Category 5E, as shown here, is characterized to a maximum 100 MHz, with the dB values decreasing as the frequency increases. Recall that a higher dB value is better, since it means there's relatively more signal than leakage at the source or destination end. These values show that crosstalk becomes more of a problem at higher frequencies. Here are the limits for Category 6, which is characterized to 250 MHz versus 100 MHz for Cat 5e. The limits at a given frequency up to 100 MHz are higher for Cat 6 than for Cat 5e, due to the better performance of the cables, connectors, and cords. Next, we have the limits for augmented Category 6 or Cat 6A, which is characterized to 500 MHz versus 250 MHz for Cat 6. The limits shown here are the same as those seen previously for Category 6 up to 250 MHz, with additional values added to extend the characterization to 500 MHz. And our last stop is Category 8, which is a shielded-only cabling system characterized to 2000 MHz or 2 GHz, with a maximum channel length of 30 meters instead of the usual 100, and a maximum permanent link length of 24 meters instead of the usual 90. That's it, we're done. Thanks for watching.